Bien qu'on soit en avance, tu es d'accord, Olivier ?
Oui. Non, de toute façon, Hervé a fini son intervention. Donc, c'est peut-être dommage pour les internautes qui avaient prévu de se connecter à partir de 11h15, comme c'était prévu initialement pour que nous parlions de l'arthroscopie de hanche, qui est un sujet qui me tient à cœur.
The next topic will be the hip.
May I just remind and recall that
you'll have the opportunity to visualize these surgeries later on, but you'll be able to visualize it later on. We can now interact, listen to your questions, comments, but you'll have the opportunity to visualize all these surgeries and the question and answer sessions later on. But of course, you won't have the opportunity to ask the questions. It will be too late.
Après avoir répondu à cette question, on va enchaîner avec la. La présentation que Olivier nous propose.
Now going to turn to Olivier Bringer.
We're going to deal with the acetabular
impingement.
Acetabular
impingement.
L'arthroscopie de hanche, je crois qu'il est.
By way of introduction, I think we could listen to what this surgery really means. But beforehand, I've got one question by Eric.
Bonjour, good morning. Avoir avec ce type de
what type of sports can you practice with this type of prothesis? Talking about, of course, a knee prosthesis. Hervé has left. I'm going to answer in his stead, and Olivier can also take over. With a total knee prosthesis, I would say that there is no limitation directly connected to the implant itself. This implant is really solid, strong, compatible with many sports activities, jogging.
Ce n'est pas tant la prothèse qui va limiter.
Is quite possible and feasible.
Patient, le patient lui-même.
And the main limiting factor is a patient, because we often operate on elderly patients, and I can tell you that I operated on a professional sports woman who was running the marathon 2 years prior to being operated, and she went through the TKA. And she resumed sport 6 months post-surgery. There are also some people who like skiing, and skiing is quite compatible with knee prothesis. You are not far from the Pyrenees, Eastern Pyrenees here, and the mountaineering, and trekking is quite compatible with knee prothesis. If you are a huntsman, you can go back hunting if you feel like it. Now, when it comes to other sports, you have to be more careful. It mainly depends on the patient's physical health status, actually. Thanks very much for your question. Eric is a physiotherapist, I think, hence his question. May I add one word to answer his question?
Les activités sportives qui seront possibles, comme l'a dit le docteur
Cassar, as stated by Dr. Cassar, patients can have many sports activities. The only limitations will be the flexion capacity. Some patients can recover excellent flexion. Some have more limited flexion. And if you want to go skiing, of course, you need good flexion. And then may I also say that you cannot tell, you have to tell the patient, you have to tell your patients, and we try and avoid TKA in patients under 60, but if you do TKA in patients under 60, you have to tell them, you must tell them that the mechanical stresses, especially long-term stresses, will be greater than average, and they will decrease the life cycle of the prosthesis of the implant, which they can understand, of course, but they have to be forewarned and to understand. And if they clearly understand that there may be a loosening of the prosthesis of a greater wear, they'll make their own decision. I fully agree with you, it's crucial. The wear has to be taken into account.
Voilà, bah écoutez, donc, je crois qu'on va pouvoir passer
okay, I think we're going to be able to go on to our project.
Du coup, pour vous, pour remercier les deux chirurgiens qui m'ont initié à cette technique chirurgicale,
the surgeons will be hearing from the ones I began with,
rappeler,
the difficult
la chirurgie de
l'arthroscopie
de hanche, arthroscopic hip Thierry Boyer, replacement, qui est un des pionniers de cette chirurgie en France et dans le monde, et qui exerce toujours, tous les deux, dans une clinique à Paris.
Not only in France,
donc,
in
on va,
world.
Si c'est possible, donc, faire cette présentation de cette technique-là en deux temps.
Perhaps
le premier
we
temps
could have
sera la
presented
présentation
in two stages. First,
d'un PowerPoint qui va nous
we'll see a PowerPoint
permettre de nous familiariser
presentation,
avec d'abord la technique, puis
which will
les indications.
Tell us a bit more about
j'ai quelques
the
petits
technique,
films à vous présenter aussi. Et puis, à la fin,
short
on
films.
Passera donc cette intervention en direct qu'on
and
a filmée
we'll
et qui est du coup étant différée aujourd'hui.
Well, it was live at the time. We're going to be seeing a reproduction.
Okay, donc on va, tu vas nous faire ta présentation.
Donc je commence la présentation.
On va peut-être mettre ça en plein écran.
A replay. You can see up here on the screen.
Voilà, donc je vous rappelle, pour ceux qui connaissent un petit peu cette technique et pour ceux qui ne la connaissent pas du tout,
for those of you who are slightly familiar with the technique or not at all familiar,
c'est anecdotique, le docteur Burman, qui pour la première
Burman
fois a mis une caméra dans une pièce anatomique dans les années 30, ce qui est donc très, très ancien. Il avait conclu à la suite de cette expérience qu'il était quasiment impossible de voir quoi que ce soit dans l'articulation de la hanche. Et donc sa voix avait porté jusque dans les années 80, puisque ce n'est qu'à partir des années 80 que d'autres anatomistes, mais surtout chirurgiens, se sont penchés sur la question.
Anatomical specialists, but particularly surgeons, began looking at it. We should point out in France, Dr. Boyer and Dr. Dorfman were pioneers. And of course, we had doctors in the U.S. In both countries,
different approaches
were used then, and they continue to be used
to
this day.
Faire des arthroscopies en commençant par le compartiment périphérique que je vous expliquerai tout à l'heure et les États-Unis Johnson et Click ont commencé par le compartiment central, c'est-à-dire qu'ils commencent à rentrer dans l'articulation elle-même avant d'aller vers le col fémoral. Les Français commencent par le compartiment périphérique, c'est-à-dire autour du col fémoral avant d'aller dans l'articulation elle-même. Les étapes principales de l'historique de cette technique sont aussi le début des années 2000 avec Gantz qui a décrit dans une publication le conflit fémoro-acétabulaire antérieur qui a révolutionné la compréhension des douleurs, notamment chez les sportifs, des douleurs de hanche chez les sportifs.
Which was a cause of pain in
et donc, inévitablement, une fois ce conflit découvert, sa physiopathologie
the pathophysiology was understood,
d'envisager un traitement.
And then it was necessary to foresee
some
kind of treatment, which was an open operation with very wide margins. That was very frustrating for surgeons.
But de gradually faire de la chirurgie the idea emerged de ce type de of doing
arthroscopic surgery of this type of impingement in all specialties, particularly because it was less aggressive, less invasive. Obviously, there's an implant you're putting in, it's invasive in that sense, but regard to the rest of the surgery, you can use arthroscopy.
ISHA est l'International Society of Hip Arthroscopy.
The International Society of Hip Arthroscopy is a body, a think tank created in 2008.
So it's fairly recent.
And in 2012, the ISHA Boston meeting convened 400 surgeons from around the planet. Still highly confidential. Just want to interrupt because I have a question from one of our viewers on the previous subject. That's what's nice about being here live. Jack is a physical therapist and wonders why there's sometimes a flaw in extension or flexion or a poor bending moment. And there's also congratulations from him to the surgeon. So why is there this deficit in terms of flexion and extension? Well, there are many aspects that could be mentioned. There are occasionally patients who previously, even before the operation, have this deficit in extension or flexion, and it can be considerable. It's not always possible to recover the entire range of motion in an operated knee when we're talking about this type of osteoarthritis. When you take the patient in, if it's someone you haven't seen before, what you do first is try to find out what the mobility was before the operation. In extension and flexion, there may be different types of deficits. The orthopedic surgeon, when placing or positioning the implant, has to be careful to make sure there's a good balancing of the ligaments, both in extension and flexion, so that the widest possible range of motion is achieved. The surgical technique here is really important. And then there's what we call a release of ligaments. The ligaments have become more contracted, over time, and so the idea is to, of course, release those ligaments so they gain mobility, and this also will take place after with rehabilitation. Now, when you have a 10-degree extension defect and you're operating on this knee and you may not be able to recover all that range of motion, you should have the surgeon who's operated on the patient talk with the patient to find out what the cause was, particularly in extension, because we know with flexion is less important, or at least we can say in extension it's more difficult to recover that range of motion, so we don't want to just leave it like that. And we tell patients afterward, when they're in the outpatient unit or they're getting rehabilitation, they shouldn't hesitate to get back into contact with us if they need to. Of course, the rehabilitator, the patient, and the surgeon should constantly be in communication. We shouldn't tolerate an extension defect in terms of as a result. However, we may not look for more than 120, 130 degrees, and you can have a totally normal life with a knee that bends 120 degrees. Maybe you can't bring your foot up to your butt, but you can survive, you can live very well. Well, it depends on their patient's expectations. Some have 90 degrees of flexion and they're delighted, and some are looking for more. It depends a lot on the patient. And then there was the last question.
L'œdème, bon, il y a plusieurs facteurs. Il y a le geste chirurgical lui-même
qui va générer
un blocage au retour veineux. Y a aussi,
well,
le
we have
de anglais, mauvais déroulé du pas,
the occasionally when people use a cane and the foot rolls to one side or the other. And that has an effect on it. So post-op with the patient's leg up, we can have the physical therapist that can do a drainage, and they have to stop using a cane. I try to do that as early as the walking sticks. I try to use that, do that as soon as possible and get the patient back moving again.
On nous regarde depuis Tahiti.
Somebody sent us a message from Tahiti.
On a les félicitations de
and they've congratulated
de Guillaume.
Guillaume.
Qui nous dit super conférence.
They said it's a great conference and hi from the other side of the world, from Tahiti, to all of your, to your entire team. Do you know Guillaume?
Guillaume
Apparition is a friend of ours.
En stage,
he's currently there in a training period.
De formation et donc il
a training
avait,
course.
Il avait été alerté de cette,
and
de
he
cette
was told that we would have this webcast, and we're very
merci
delighted
Guillaume.
To have him on the other side of the planet saying hi to us from there. So hello to you.
Bien, je te laisse reprendre ton diaporama,
le cours,
Olivier.
Le cours de mon diaporama. Merci.
So we'll go back to our slideshow.
Donc, sur le plan des indications.
From the standpoint of indications,
séparer deux grands groupes d'indications dans les
we have two large groups of indications for arthroscopic hip replacement.
C'est une façon de séparer les indications qui m'est propre. Hein, de, ça n'a pas de, de valeur scientifique particulière.
This is not scientifically done. It's more my preferences, but I've divided them into two therapeutic arthroscopy, where
what
we see is very it's very clear. We can before we even go in there, we can see the type of pathology we're dealing with. The most frequent one is the femoral acetabular impingement with associated lesions, normally of the labrum. Then we have isolated lesions of the labrum.
Est un fibrocartilage un petit peu comme le ménisque au niveau du genou, et que le développement de la chirurgie sous arthroscopie de hanche a permis de mettre en évidence qu'on pouvait le traiter un petit peu comme un ménisque, avec des possibilités de réinsertion et des possibilités de résection en fonction des chances de cicatrisation. Le dernier des grandes indications thérapeutiques avec une iconographie qui est positive avant le geste, c'est l'ostéochondromatose que vous connaissez.
Then we have osteochondromatosis. You're all familiar with that. When you have foreign bodies in the joint. There's another part which is even more interesting from the scientific standpoint, which is those what I would call diagnostic and therapeutic arthroscopy with pain and instability, but whether the imaging is MRI or X-rays and to bear this out. And some years ago, this was being done in the shoulder, and we were able to see using this arthroscopy that we discovered a whole range of pathologies we weren't aware of. With arthroscopy, what we discovered was the pectinofoveal crease in the synovial area,
or the fold.
And you can also have, as I say, synovitis, in this fold,
un petit peu comme dans le genou avec une
just as with the the knee, where you can have an inflammatory synovitis, you can have an impingement with the psoas, which is just under the anterior capsule, and this fold that generates inflammation and pain. That you can see only with an arthroscopy, because there's no arthroscanner or other MRI which could detect it. Or at least it would be very difficult to do so, and you might easily miss it.
The second pathology is
the one of the
sportives, notamment
the teres ligament.
qui ont des amplitudes extrêmes, notamment les danseuses.
And for example, dancers often tear this ligament and this extreme pain, excruciating pain, this happened. And once the teres ligament has been torn, either you have this extreme pain and hypertrophy of the persisting fragment, or you can get instability. It's rare, but it has been reported in the literature.
Some very
good surgeons do a ligamentoplasty of the teres ligament.
Petite, il y a quelques cas, évidemment.
There's not a lot of them that's been done, but it has been done. Something else that was discovered thanks to arthroscopy was subluxation.
Tous les ressauts de hanche intra-articulaire. When
the hip comes out,
we see
subluxation of the labrum, and what that does is it creates a clicking
when it's inflamed,
with an inflammation of the psoas tendon, which is subluxated forward from the acetabulum.
Arthroscopy
has also created a whole, a lot more information around pain around the prosthesis. Some, for example, squeaking, which can be explored. In some hips, which had noises, these were ceramic prosthesis, and you couldn't see it under normal imaging, but once you could see a slight crack
thanks
to arthroscopy, it was very clear that you had to change the prosthesis because the ceramic breakdown in the medium or long time would lead to a fracture and so forth. So naturally, we wanted to operate that before.
Évidemment les résections, biopsies synoviales.
And also resection and synovial biopsies were another reason for using arthroscopy. I said it's complex and you need a lot of material, a lot of instruments. As you can see here, this is a traction, an orthopedic traction table with an adapted boot, traction booth, and all of the arthroscopy equipment.
Arthropompe, c'est-à-dire un moyen,
you need an, what we call an arthropompe,
du liquide à l'intérieur de l'articulation,
to put liquid in the joint, and we have this two-way flow, just as we use for shoulder arthroscopies.
It was used originally for shoulder arthroscopies,
and now we use it for the hip as well.
Bien sûr, une radiofréquence,
we also need radio frequency, just as we do in shoulder operations, and a shaver and a burr.
For the arthroscopy,
the initial exploration with the camera requires the most material. I would add to that, and you can't see it on this slide,
perioperative radioscopy,
particularly in the first cases
donc
that one does.
Now, française dont je vais vous parler,
I'm going to be talking about the French technique,
que l'on qualifie de périphérique première,
which we refer to as a first or primary peripheral operation. You can see on the X-ray on the right
a
joint space around the femoral neck near the head.
Et c'est dans cette zone-là qui est de la tache blanche sur la radioscopie.
You see that white spot.
Par l'intermédiaire d'une aiguille, puis
with a
cannule,
you have a pin there and a cannula.
On met le scope à l'intérieur de
and
cette
you put
zone.
The scope inside that area.
Uniquement dans un second temps.
And in a second stage,
traction
is when using traction
central.
We go into the
donc
central compartment.
J'insiste sur cet
I would like to stress that aspect.
Pour une raison importante. c'est que quand on rentre dans le compartiment central en premier, il y a toujours un risque de lésion du cartilage. Cette technique qui a été développée par le docteur Boyer, essentiellement à Paris, permet d'éviter les lésions du cartilage, puisqu'en fait, l'entrée dans le compartiment central se fait sous contrôle de la vue.
Donc, deux petites images de ce qu'on peut voir.
Dans un compartiment périphérique.
This is looking at the peripheral compartment on the left and the central compartment on the right.
Donc une petite vidéo, si je peux la lancer. Est-ce que la régie, s'il vous plaît, pourrait nous lancer?
Let's see if we can get that video now.
De la diapositive. Je pense que je ne peux pas la lancer.
I don't think I can turn it on from where I am here.
Voilà,
there we
bien.
Go.
Donc les deux vidéos sont parties en même temps, mais
the two videos are on at the same time, but on the upper part of the screen, you can see this is the exploration of the peripheral compartment, as I've said before, with the femoral neck on left, on the right, just around before the labrum. Here you can see the two major folds of the pecnofoveal fold I referred to earlier, and on the left, I think we can see it later, the articular fold. These are the two major folds in the peripheral compartment of the hip.
Voilà ce qu'on peut trouver. Une petite photo d'une lésion du bourrelet.
Here we see a quick picture of a lésion of the labrum. The same as for a torn meniscus. These are lesions which are not cannot be repaired, so we have to resect them. You can see on the right, at the upper right, the result of the resection. When there's a reinsertion, which wasn't done for the previous lesion, here is what we might see if we were able to reinsert the labrum. And here we have this labral clicking affecting the hip. And as I said before, you would never have been able to see a picture like this until arthroscopy started to be used. Here you're looking at an audible click. If it's not painful, there's no problem, but if there is pain, we may have to go in. Here's the famous pectinofoveal fold, the impingement, where it's inflammation and pain in the hip, which was we couldn't explain before. You can see very well in this image, in the film of the arthroscopy later, we see it less well because there's also a synovitis, which I'll talk about later. Here is a typical foreign body, which you can find in any joint, in the knee very particularly. All knee surgeons are familiar with this. This was foreign body in femoral acetabular compartment.
An
osteochondromatosis.
Here
we had a rupture of the teres ligament.
On
the left, you have the normal ligament
central,
in the central compartment. Really nice vision of the rupture, the tear, with an hypertrophy that is visible here. So you can understand why this would lead to persistent pain. The two lower pictures show that the ligamentoplasty of the teres ligament.
Je vous ai parlé donc du vaste champ d'exploration.
And there's a lot of exploration that's been done with the hip via arthroscopy. And as I said earlier, we can see a cracking of the ceramic liner, and that leads to noise. It creates noise. And we used to think it wasn't important, or else we would go in all over again. But we weren't really sure of the pathology or the cause. We have an image of this prosthesis, which we could never have been able to see the or diagnose the fracture of the liner, a ceramic liner rather, before. But here we see these cracks. And once you go in again, you see the ceramic insert or liner was damaged.
Une autre un autre débouché entre guillemets de la
another use of arthroscopy for prosthesis is all the anterior
part.
This often happens with hip prosthesis. We have a lot of pathologies of the psoas area
just
before the acetabular implants. Here we see an impingement between the psoas tendon, which was damaged, and the prosthesis polyethylene. So it might need a resection of a fragment of polyethylene to avoid this impingement, or
a resection
of part of the psoas muscle under arthroscopy, which could resolve the problem and remove, eliminate
donc,
pain.
Comme je vous en parlais tout à l'heure, le conflit
femoro-acetabulaire,
the
femoral acetabular impingement
la pathologie phare
is
de
the
cette
typical
cela concerne
pathology
les
for this
patients
new surgery.
Jeunes et sportifs
These are their young athletic patients, as a rule, who need this surgery, and consequently, they are required to be able to have high knee flexion. Hip flexion.
Est-ce que vous pourriez me faire passer le petit film qui montre
I'd like to now show a video to show the
pathophysiology
of femoral acetabular impingement.
Voilà, excusez-moi, je prenais un petit peu d'eau.
I'm just going to stop and drink some water, says the speaker.
Sur cette, petite vidéo, l'effet cam
antérieur, here you see the cam, the anterior cam effect.
Ce qu'on peut appeler la bosse sur la partie antérieure du
the
col
bump
femoral,
on the anterior facet of the femoral neck, where there's an and there's an impingement when it enters in contact with the labrum. And in over time, when the, as a result of this flexion, there's a tearing of the insertion or the body itself of the labrum.
Ceux qui ne sont pas habitués à cette terminologie. Et évidemment, la phase ultérieure du conflit femoro-acetabulaire, ce sont les lésions cartilagineuses. We have cartilage lesions
as a result. If we don't fix it, so we want to resolve the CAM effect before we have a lesion of the cartilage. Especially because we're talking about young athletic patients. So we have to get it early on, otherwise it can mean the end of their career. And now we know the origin of this pain. We try to do this in a mini-invasive way because hip arthroscopy is precisely that.
La vidéo suivante, s'il vous plaît.
We have the next video then.
C'est une petite vidéo qui vous explique un petit peu ce que vous allez voir sur le film.
You're going to see again on the film, but you see we enter the joint capsule anteriorly, and we position the arthroscope to be able to see inside the femoral acetabular joint.
Ensuite, il va falloir ouvrir cette fameuse capsule.
Then we will open this articular capsule. You see, it's quite thick.
Donc la capsule est ouverte.
The capsule is open.
Petit à petit, progressivement, avec little de ce qu'on appelle
little,
un shaver.
Using a shaver.
Alors là, l'instrument qui est utilisé est
un petit bistouri adapté. Here is a tiny scalpel, an adapted one. I don't use it myself, I must say, but some surgeons do. And here you can see the different stages in the operator, and it's important to see how it works before the surgery itself. We have a first stage with resection of the capsule, then we're preparing the femoral neck in the area where the CAM effect takes place, and we have the bump on the anterior facet of the neck, and then we use a burr to resect that CAM effect area. You don't see the central arthroscopic period that's a second stage. Then we have traction. You don't really see it in this photo, but we do debridement and reinsertion of the labrum. The labrum being the cause of that CAM effect on the labrum. Here's the case of a patient, and you'll see the film later. This patient is 32 years old. She's an amateur dancer, but she practices regularly. And like all such patients, she has the medial flexion rotation produces pain. You can see a profile of dunes on imaging. A dune imaging. Now, it's not highly visible. In some patients, well, we can see it more in some than other. The impingement or CAM effect was fairly moderate this time. And on the arthro scanner, you can see this. You can see the lesion in the labrum. Here, it's highly visible. It's very clear. You'll see the setup, then a dorsal position with the knee flexed at 30 to 40 degrees, which releases and relaxes the anterior capsule, and it makes it easier for us to get in there with our instruments. So we want the hip at 30 degrees. In the peripheral compartment, the arthroscopy is done at 30 degrees, and it's important to underscore that traction is done at the end of the procedure, only to manage the central compartment, to see the damage of any damage to the cartilage and the labrum, and to see any possible damage on the front and back part of the labrum. Now, there are two main approaches for hip arthroscopy. The most frequent would be anterior or anterolateral, partway between the base of the greater cotentiger and the higher superior iliac spine. And here we have the upper trochanteric entry point. This is more schematic. Here we see the peripheral compartment. I referred before to the neck of the femur. Here you can see the peripheral compartment approach. You have to go where the little asterisk is, and that's a challenge in radioscopy. It's very important, or in x-rays, it's very important to mark the peripheral point right where you have an X there. You cannot use arthroscopy here because that famous orbicular fold, which I referred to before, which keeps you from seeing the central compartment. If you go distal to this compartment, you won't be able to treat central lesions. So it's very important to go into the proximal peripheral compartment. As I was saying with the previous slide, you have to enter the proximally and not, as the red pin shows, distally. Now, to go deeply into the joint, what we do is we use a long needle, a cannulated needle, and we have a guide wire we use, we call the nitinol guide wire. Once we finish with our peripheral compartment, we go to the central compartment, we perform traction, and we go to the area that's in pink on that slide. And now, I think we can go to the video. Well, thank you so much for that wonderful theoretical or theory presentation of the theory of the arthroscopy operation before we get into action and see it live. This technique is quite a recent one, even though, as you've rightly said, there were pioneers in France, particularly Dr. Boyer, who was one of the first ever, if not the first, to use and promote this technique. We can still refer to this technique as being quote-unquote confidential, particularly because very few surgeons are using it yet, and also because of the indications. Now, we're going to get into action, and you will be talking about the surgery you performed. We've got the film here, so it's not live. It's a film. The instruments are very specific. You need very long instruments. The only arthroscopy is the only one that needs such long instruments because it's a very deep operation. In the hip, you have that 30-degree flexion, as I told you before. The arthroscope is at 70 degrees. Those of you who use arthroscopy frequently, this is quite particular. It takes a while to get used to this angle of vision at 70 degrees. It's unlike typical knee and shoulder. Shoulder arthroscopy, which is at 30 degrees. As I said earlier, we use a radioscopy, making it easier to get into the famous peripheral zone, as I said before, which is the best adapted approach. Now, you have the end of this knee, or the coming into the anterior facet of the neck. We just check to see if it's placed correctly, positioned correctly. We don't have the capsular attachments. Now we use a scope to check this approach. Well, when we get used to doing this, as we get more experience, we don't need it. But I think when you're starting out, and anybody who wants to start out has to understand that you really need to check everything, because otherwise you can get discouraged. Remember, the hip is a very deep joint, and it's very difficult to find your way in the space between 10 and at a thickness of 10 and 20 centimeters. It's quite different in that regard from the knee. Well, I think it's probably true for arthroscopy in general, but particularly in the case of the hip, the quality and precision of our approach will be everything else hinges on. Yes, that's why the setup is so important when you're getting ready for your approach, and then, of course, positioning the instruments. So you prepare the approach first, and then the rest will happen. Well, actually, that applies to all kinds of orthopedic surgery. You can see the trocar and the instruments being placed. This is an optical trocar with one with a scope. It enables us to place the scope, which is longer. It's almost 10 centimeters longer than the one we use for the knee, and it enables us to go in deeply into the peripheral compartment. What's different from the previous picture we saw, we had in the other case, we had a synovitis and impingement, so we had much less visibility. But as we go with this patient who had a synovitis, we'll gradually see more the anatomical landmarks. One thing we'll be seeing later is what you've got to understand. Until you've done the capsule resection, and I'm talking about a large resection in that joint, it's impossible to move around in the joint, and that's what's different from other arthroscopies.
Je rappelle à nos internautes.
I'd like to recall, for those of you who are watching us,
à tout moment pour ceux qui nous rejoignent et que je salue.
And those who have also come in since we began, you are welcome to send in messages over the FMC chat system. Even though this wasn't live, we can stop the video at any time. That's the advantage, actually. We can rewind and if need be. That's what's different with respect to live surgery. Obviously, you can't rewind live. That was just a note I wanted to make. I think with this full-screen view, we'll be more comfortable. This is the first approach. First, we had the arthroscope in the anterior approach with the superior trunk anteric area. With this instrument, we can place the shaver or resector. That's the part that's the most difficult, which is using the shaver. Later, we're going to be resecting the cam and treating the labrum, but this is nevertheless an essential stage in the operation, and you can't do anything until you've done this. You can see, it looks like what we do when we do a synovial resection, even in a knee or a shoulder, because the first stage of a shoulder arthroscopy is resection of the subacromial bursa. And it's something, it's rather cumbersome, but you've got to do it. It's important to, for those of you who are watching us, to say that arthroscopic surgery, which from outside might actually appear simpler because you only are using a couple of instruments that you're using in the human body, in the joints. Don't forget that you still require all of the stages, setting up the patient and seeing the best approach for the joint, and when you're doing open surgery, there's a period for dissection. Well, here, in this case, you could refer to this time as a period of arthroscopic preparation of the operating site. I would just like to ask you a question, Olivier, on that. You said before, very rightly, that the hip is the deepest joint to operate on. Well, we know there are some nerves, the sciatic nerve, among others, that are very nearby, and major vessels that irrigate the lower limb. Could you tell us a little bit about any possible risks of this operation? It's important to know what you're doing. What are the risks? I would say the risks, unlike what you might imagine, are not about it's not about vessels and nerves. And precisely, that's because of the work done by our predecessors, in particular Dr. Boyer himself. Gradually, they've developed approaches that keep us away from such delicate or sensitive parts of the body. It's almost impossible to damage the sciatic nerve because the most posterior place is at the top of the trochanter, so it's far away. And the anterior approach is also quite different from the quite distant from the femoral nerve, so we don't run much of a risk there. Of course, there's a possibility of having more difficult pathologies in the hip. I won't go into detail, but that would lead us to have to take a little bit more challenging approaches, be more ambitious, But 80 or 90% of the indications for hip arthroscopy don't involve major risks. The only real risk, I would say, is the traction time, because when the traction time can create problems. We see the anatomical part. You see the labrum here with a little bit of a yellowish reflection. You can see the damage due to the impingement. Resecting the, when we resect here, we can better view the labrum and the anterior facet of the collar. I'm glad you mentioned that about the risks of this surgery. Well, it appears very impressive, and at the same time, if you're familiar with anatomy, you know you are distant from any tissue, nerves or vessels that you might otherwise damage. What can we hear about this? Here on the anterior facet of the femoral neck, right next to the labrum, and I'm preparing the anterior facet of the collar to permit subsequent resection using a burr of the CAM effect. So you see, it's very difficult to see it in the joint space. That's why it's so important to have this pre-op planning, because the landmarks, 3D landmarks, are difficult to see when you're between the joints. That's what we saw in the pre-op exams, and that's how we defined the resection area. Generally, that's between 12 o'clock and 7 in the anterior facet. The lower limit is the plectinofoveal fold, which we can constantly keep an eye on. After the resection of the joint capsule and synovial resection, cauterizing here to avoid blood. This is a radio frequency electrode, which is used to coagulate or cauterize the area, and also to complete the resection that we began with the shaver. This is still prep time. We still haven't gone in completely into the resection of the CAM and treatment of the labrum lesion, which will be the second stage. This, in fact, looks like any other arthroscopic operation. You prepare the operating field before you actually begin acting on the pathophysiology, one might say. I'm referring here to the anterior CAM effect and the labrum. Thus far, we haven't seen the lesion itself, have we? Well, the CAM, as I was saying, is quite difficult to see using arthroscopy. It's because of our pre-op programming that we know where it is. Particularly in cases like this, where it's fairly mild and it's very difficult to see when you're actually in the operating room. However, the labrum is quite visible, but that's the last stage. I would like to mention that the last operating stage corresponds to the first operating stage in English-speaking countries. Here you see the facet of the neck. Which is sprayed. I just like to mention you really need a lot of preparation with, from the standpoint of instruments. I see you're using a unipolar electrode, a high quality shaver, and a display unit that's a good one. And what do you use otherwise for your pump? Usual pressure, as I do for all arthroscopies. However, it is true that the dual flow arthro pump makes it possible in a short space of time to perform this better, because just as in shoulder synovia, what happens is that there's bleeding, and that interrupts our field of vision. A good arthro pump is really needed, and I don't think you should start doing this kind of surgery until you have all of the material you need, because you can get pretty discouraged, because without the right instruments, it's really impossible to perform this surgery. We're going to finish the resection a little more distally on the femoral neck. When you're talking about a simple lesion of the labrum, this wouldn't be necessary. A T resection of the capsule is only required when we're treating the anterior cam on the femur. If it's just the labrum, you don't have to be that extensive. I'm going to sound like a novice here, but this is an interesting question. Can it happen that you have to convert the arthroscopic operation to an open operation? I've never had that experience myself. I can't imagine why that would happen, because you have the traction and the orthopedic table, so you'd have to completely modify the patient's position. It's not an option that you consider when you start this surgery, particularly because the approach to a hip is so essential. There are no problems with this surgery if you do a broad capsule resection. There's no reason to reconvert. So a priori, we don't need to go to an open operation. We almost never have any vessel lesions, so that wouldn't be a reason. Sometimes you would convert it to an open operation if you had a vessel lesion, but this isn't the case. Now we get to the burring, using the reamer to resect the cam, the side of resection, or rather the depth, says the speaker, will determine the thickness of the cam. Be determined by the thickness of the cam.
Quel est le temps moyen pour toi pour réaliser ce geste?
What's the average amount of time you need? On average, an hour and a half. So we actually shortened the film a little bit to make it not so tedious. With the flexion, we can determine that the resection of the cam has been sufficient. That's very important when you finish resecting the cam, to make sure that there's no more impingement between the anterior facet of the neck and the labrum. You can see an orange there. You can see the anterior facet of the femoral neck on the arthroscopic image. We're between two stages, between the peripheral and central phases. Now we're going to go to the central phase with traction on the leg and opening of the central compartment on the right-hand screen. And here you are in the central compartment without having a wrist damaging the cartilage, thanks to beginning with the peripheral approach. Now we're in the central compartment, and the labrum is floating now because it's no longer held in place by the femoral head. And now we're going to explore the central compartment. We can see that the cartilage has not been damaged. That's a great news for the future of this joint. And very quickly, what we will see, however, is the lesion of the labrum, which appears in the inferior or the lower part here, you can see the tear, which is looks exactly like a meniscal tear. It's very, very obvious. From the therapeutic standpoint, you'd probably take the same decisions as for a meniscus. Little by little, this positioning makes it possible to see the lesion. And as I said earlier, you can see that the lesion of the meniscus goes down very close to the cartilage. And that's where we can see very easily that if this impingement were allowed to continue, the labrum lesion would lead to a loosening of this cartilage, and that would create real problems, particularly when we're talking about a young patient and we don't want to put a prosthesis in. It would be really a shame to put a hip prosthesis in a young and an athletic patient who has a future before them. I have a question from one of our viewers from Paris
who asks la résection
whether
antérieure du
anterior
femoral
resection of the femoral neck could
le col lui-même,
weaken
mais est-ce qu'il y a
the neck
un risque
itself. Is there a risk,
de
at least in theory, of a future fracture
Alors,
there?
Ou est-ce que ça a été décrit?
Or has that been reported yet?
Le risque majeur,
well, I would say the major risk. You know, I said it's difficult to see the CAM from the geometric standpoint. After the resection, you need, if you over resect, you can over-ream the femoral neck, and you could have the, if you over-ream there, you do have the risk of a fracture, but that's only if you've over-reamed. That's why it's so important before the operation to program everything and take every precaution possible. The main risk involved in this surgery in the beginning is not because you are afraid of over-resecting, you leave a too big a CAM, and then the other risk would be to over-resect and to risk a fracture. That's why it's important to get used to the technique so that you don't weaken the femoral neck.
Tu disposes d'une exploration par imagerie de ton col fémoral post-opératoire.
Do you have imaging of the femoral neck after the operation? Well, it's very difficult to ask patients who are doing well to come back and do an arthro scanner, a joint scanner, joint scan. But we try to do an after AP view and see the femoral resection that's been performed. Right now, I would be happy to get a view that would show how it went after the operation. And little by little, we become more expert in our resection. This is a resection with the shaver together with the joint capsule. We resect where the area of the labrum that's involved. We don't want to over-resect the labrum. The same problem is with the meniscus, because in the beginning of knee arthroscopy, we tended to resect the entire meniscus area, and then we learned we shouldn't do that. So based on that experience, we don't want to resect the whole labrum, but only the part that's damaged.
Les images sont d'une très grande clarté. Et ça démontre par l'image et par l'exemple.
This is very clear. I have to say, and looking at this example, those who up until now have been reticent can see that it's perfectly possible to use arthroscopy for the hip joint. And I think the our viewers can see, even though it's not direct, it's not live, I could say, that's always magical, but we can still still get a very good view of what you've
très,
done.
Très démonstratif, hein. On voit bien le conflit qui est levé.
You
qui
can
se lève
see the impingement, which
et puis aussi on perçoit bien
gradually is
très, très peu agressif de cette chirurgie, puisque finalement à aucun moment tu rentres en contact
and
de manière agressive avec
there's it's not invasive because you never touch the cartilage itself.
D'autant que les patients
yes, that's quite a challenge. It's particularly because they're young athletic patients and we want them to get back to their sport. I mean, that's what they want from us. We also have to underscore that the final result we get with this type of surgery from the standpoint of the bone and the labrum will take some months. And in the case of lingamentoplasty, beforehand we have to convince the patients to wait before beginning their activity again. They have to be, we have to get them into that mindset. After this, I know you have some demonstrations, and we'll go directly there afterward with Mathieu and his shoulder surgery. Could you say a word or two on the symptoms? Because it seems to me that one of the particularities of lesions of the labrum is that they are not injuries that are well known. And we don't usually see them on typical x-rays, and the symptoms aren't always well known either. So when should they come and see you, and what are the additional exams or tests required when somebody has hip pains that we can't explain away? Well, all too often, they're diagnosed as having tendinitis, and it's true, the tendinitis diagnosis, unfortunately, is a kind of a like a basket that you throw everything into. That's what everything is called, and we don't know what it is. Well, precisely, right? With this new surgery, we're just seeing the same thing as we saw with those capsulohumeral arthritis of the shoulder. As surgery has developed, and we're talking about this pathology was well known, so there, just as in the shoulder, in the hip, everything was referred to as periarthritis or tendinitis or pubalgia, which wasn't the reality. And exploring in this new way, with this new technology, has enabled us to see that behind those terms, there are actually other pathologies. For a young athletic patient with pain, with hip pain, which is very often difficult to define because each patient will describe their pain differently, we always have to imagine that there may be either an injury to the labrum or femoroacetabular impingement, and we really need this patient to see an orthopedic surgeon who uses arthroscopy. And you can do this with a simple x-ray because a joint scan is going to be decisive. You need, I think, between having someone who's going to treat you for a tendinitis or going to see a surgeon who will have you do a joint scan, that's an important choice. So a differential diagnosis is required because normally in the clinical exam you see the pain and you have to determine which patients are going to require a joint scan because that's invasive. But we only do that when we're really suspicious that this might be the case. Well, first of all, because it's not that familiar in our profession, you have to think about it, and then you have to go to an experienced surgeon who can take care of it. You should never forget about standard x-rays. That's also important in diagnosing what's going on. And we need an experienced surgeon who, together with you, can read and interpret these diagnoses, which have to be done very carefully. From the scan standpoint, is there anything else you have to look for? Well, we're talking about the classical cup, sagittal and frontal cuts. Labrum lesions are difficult to see, and you're right. Here we are lucky enough to have very good joint radiologists, and they do wonderful imaging, and that enables us to do precise operations and treatments.
C'est vraiment très très intéressant. On arrive là à la fin, je crois, de ta retransmission vidéo. Ça a été,
I think we've reached the end.
Je ne sais pas si on va avoir une
this was very clear.
De ta résection du col.
We see the, the resection of the neck. Well, in particular, when we release the traction and we're integrating the head in position, back to its initial position. Just a word, since we have a few, we have time. You say you don't rebuild the teres ligament at the Lesca Congress in Amsterdam. I saw an Indian surgeon who did ligamentoplasties of this type. I think it's quite bold. In my practice, I'd like to know what the indications for that might be. Well, they're very rare, because usually you don't get tears of the teres ligament in athletes. It should only be suggested in the case of proven instability of the hip, particularly in patients who can no longer practice their sport. And here you can see, yes, recoaptation, closing, first closing these approach cuts. It's when you consider how deep we've gone, the scarring is almost invisible, and post-op pain is almost non-existent. And that's amazing, really, when you consider how deeply we've gone. Well, bravo, bravo. I've learned a lot. I'm not familiar with this technique myself, but it almost makes me want to go in and start. Yes, I'll come down to Béziers to practice. It's true, we're not very far away, and perhaps our two regions may end up merging, although that's not something that maybe our viewers are interested in, because some of them are very far away.